Welcome to Bible Tract Echoes. This program is the radio ministry of Bible Tracts Incorporated. Our mission is to take the Word of God to all the world. Our Bible teacher is the director of Bible Tracts, Pastor Mark Smith. Since 1938, Bible Tracts Incorporated has been publishing clear gospel tracts and supplying them to churches, missionaries, and individuals all over the world, and all at no charge. Information on how you can receive a free sample pack of our tracts will be given at the end of this broadcast. Now for our Bible study, here is our teacher, Pastor Mark Smith.
Good Monday to you, my friend. Welcome to the broadcast. Thanks so much for joining us today. I pray your day and your week is starting off very, very well. My Bible is sitting open right now to the book of 2 Peter chapter 3. We are rather quickly coming to the end of this study. If you can right now, reach over, pick up your own copy of the Word of God and join me there. 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 15 will be our focus here in just a moment. Besides your Bible, why don't you also get something on which you can jot some notes? We'll be giving three words, all beginning with the letter A, today to unfold what is before us in the opening line of verse 15. But with that pen and paper ready, when my announcer at the end of the broadcast gives our contact information, you'll be ready to jot down whether it be our address, our phone number, our website, whatever the case may be, so that you can give us your name and address, because I have a gift for you. I want to give you a free sample packet containing one each of all of our English gospel tracts. I'm going to talk about a particular gospel tract here in just a moment, but let me lead into our study time this way. As I'm making this broadcast, the storm named Florence is hitting the Carolinas, and at present 14 people have lost their lives, and the damage will certainly soar into the billions of dollars. Every time these kind of events come on, we hear the why questions begin to be asked. People want to know why life-altering, traumatic events like this take place. People ask why God doesn't stop them, and others ask why people build their homes and businesses in places which are so susceptible to ruin. Well, today we consider another why question. It's this one. Why does God let so many wicked and vile and utterly debauched people live so long? Why doesn't God strike them dead? Or some people ask, why hasn't God returned yet to judge the wickedness in our world? Why is God delaying his coming to judge sinners? That, friend, is the very focus and issue before us today. So get your Bible, get pen and paper, join me, please. 2 Peter chapter 3. I mentioned the gospel tracts here a moment ago. That word tracts is spelled T-R-A-C-T-S. We're referring to an evangelism tool. A gospel tract is simply a short written presentation of God's plan of salvation. We have over 40 gospel tracts. You'll find them in that free sample packet. Each one is going to come at the same gospel message, because there is only one good news for salvation. Each of the tracts is going to come at the same truth from a different vantage point. The one in my hand right now is I'm giving it, telling you about it so that you can be prepared for what's coming shortly. I'm talking about the Christmas season. This gospel track is entitled Christmas Characters. Christmas Characters. There are a number of Bible characters mentioned in this track: Zechariah and Elizabeth, Mary, Joseph, the wise men, the shepherds, the baby, and so on. And what this track lays out is why each one of these people is unusable. They should not be part of the Christmas story. They're unusable for this reason or that reason, and the reason is stated in the track, but yet here they are. God's using the unusable. The whole Christmas story demonstrates the fact that God, in his grace and mercy, takes people who are unworthy to be used, unworthy to be part of his story, part of his family, and he uses them for his honor and glory. Friend, here's a great tool to give out at Christmas time. the Christmas characters. Just one of the tracts in that sample packet. Be ready when my announcer gives our contact information. And just in case you cannot stay to the end of the broadcast, our contact can be made at our website, which is BibleTractsInc.org. All right, if your Bible's open there, look at chapter 3 of 2 Peter, verse 14 and 15 say this, "Wherefore, beloved, seeing that ye look for such things, be diligent, that ye may be found of him in peace, without spot, and blameless, and account that the long-suffering of our Lord is salvation, even as our beloved brother Paul also, according to the wisdom given unto him, hath written unto you." Just stop right there, please. Now, today, I want to primarily speak to those who are listening who do not know Jesus Christ as their Savior. The opening part of verse 15 is what I want you to see and grasp. But before I do that, let me put this whole statement here in context. The passage here, really verses 11 through 16, is about following. It answers this question, how do I, as a child of God, live for Christ and follow his ways while the world I'm living in right now is so full of sin and so full of an anti-Bible mindset? Well, in verse 14, we saw that we need to be aware that we are loved, we need to be looking, and we need to be living a certain kind of life. Did you hear the three L words there? Loved, looking, and living. Well, now let me add a fourth one. It's the word logic. You see, verse 15 opens this way. I'm reading now. "And account that the long-suffering of our Lord is salvation." One of the key marks of the last days, according to the Word of God, before Christ comes, is that people will be denying the idea that God will ever judge sinners. They deny the idea of people going to hell and that that could ever be true at all. Well, the Holy Spirit points here and promotes three basic things in the opening line of verse 15. He promotes an accounting, he promotes God's anger, and he promotes an atonement. The followers of Jesus are to have a logical view about God's apparent postponement of judgment. That's the whole idea of the word account here. The word account refers to a way of thinking or refers to a perspective on an issue. We, as human beings, of course, we live and think from our own human limited perspective. But God has given to us his perspective, which is that he will come and he will judge sinners. So we think using God's logic. But if God is so patient about bringing into this world his judgment, then there must be a reason. There must be a logic behind his delay, and there is. First, though, let me show you something in verse 15. Do you see that word long-suffering? That word literally means to have anger or fierceness that is drawn out or lengthened. When I explain this word to kids, I often use the picture of a rubber band being pulled farther and farther, being stretched and stretched and stretched more and more. Now, we all know that a rubber band, if stretched and stretched, it will eventually break. God's anger at both the sins committed and at the sinners doing those sins is being stretched out. But one day, God's patience will end and his judgment will come. It will not be because God's patience is broken, but when he comes to judge, sinners will be broken. Dear unsaved listener, listen to this Bible verse from Psalm 7. It says, "God is angry with the wicked every day." There's a number of places in the Psalms that you can read how that sinners, because they are not immediately judged, they start thinking that, well, God doesn't know about my sin, or that he'll never hold me accountable for the times that I've broken his law. That's such foolishness. That's illogical thinking. God is called the righteous judge, and he will do his judging according to his righteous standards, not yours, not mine, not your church's, not your denomination, not your grandma's, his. I use three words at the beginning today. I talked about the accounting and the anger. Let me get to my third word. It's the word atonement. Verse 15 says that God is allowing his anger to be held back so that sinners can get saved. God's salvation plan is focused on the person of God's own Son, Jesus the Christ, the Son of the living God. It is not focused, friend, on your morality. It's not focused on your religiosity. It's not focused on your good works. It's not focused on you being a good mom and dad and so on. No matter how good you think you have been, you have a sin record. And that record is kept very meticulously by God himself. He knows every thought. He knows every act. He knows every non-act that you should have done, that I should have done, all of which was contrary to his law. You see, the Bible says that sin is a transgression of God's laws, not your standards, God's laws. Jesus came to be the ultimate substitute for us. You know the story of the Old Testament, how that animals died and their blood was shed to atone for the sins that people did. But we also have enough logic to know that animals cannot really pay the penalty done by the sins of human beings. So God sent forth his Son made of a woman. That's Jesus. He came so that he would give his life, his human life, to pay the sin debt for you, for me, for the world. His blood, the Bible says, the blood of Jesus Christ cleanses us from all sin. That's the remedy for the sin record. But this payment of Jesus on Calvary's cross and this cleansing offered becomes effective only when you and I come to God. Listen now, come to God on his terms, not yours. There was a great word that my dad taught us kids. It's the word capitulate. In warfare, two armies battle, and if one capitulates, it means that they utterly surrender, and the winning side gets to set all the ground rules for how the signing of the peace will be done. They capitulate. You and I, friend, to be saved, must capitulate to God. We must come to him on his terms. We come with a repentant heart. We come with empty hands to offer nothing. We come to receive from Christ what we are totally unable to give to ourselves. We do this by placing our faith in Jesus' death and resurrection. Now tell me, have you, friend, done this? Have you capitulated to God? Have you surrendered to God? Have you come with empty hands and said, God Almighty, I'm a sinner. I have a huge sin record. I'm sorry for my sin. I've got nothing by which I can remove it. I need the blood of Jesus Christ to save me from my sin. God has delayed his anger to give you this opportunity, but this could be your last opportunity. You and I have no guarantee for tomorrow. You know it. I know it. Today is the day of salvation. Oh, beloved friend, please believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and be saved now.
Thank you for joining us today for Bible Tract Echoes. If you would like to receive a free sample packet of our tracts, you can contact us by calling 309-828-6888. Our mailing address is Bible Tracts, P.O. Box 188, Bloomington, Illinois, 61702. Again, our phone number is 309-828-6888. And our mailing address is P.O. Box 188, Bloomington, Illinois, 61702. You can also contact us through our website. Our web address is BibleTractsInc.org. Remember, the word tracts is spelled T-R-A-C-T-S. That address is BibleTractsInc.org. May the Lord richly bless you as you serve him.